If you've searched for hard drives on Amazon, you've probably seen drives that are labelled as renewed or refurbished, and they look really cheap and they look tempting, but I think the question is always, what does refurbished really mean, and can I trust what seem to be secondhand hard disks? After all, if someone is selling them, then why? So to understand this better, I bought four of these discs and I did in-depth testing on them. I looked into the reliability data on the models, the reason they're being sold, and investigated what the risks is with these discs and how to mitigate it. And you can also use this information to help you decide if you should buy these, but most importantly to know when you get a lemon and you want to return them. Now, the first thing to mention here is that these discs come from different sources. Amazon claimed to have strict requirements as to who and what can be labelled as renewed or refurbished, but know that the source of these discs and how they are handled might vary. The prices also vary, but there are some potential bargains here. So in my case, I bought four HGST 12TB Ultrastars. This model was sold and badged as both HGST and Western Digital, so they could come labelled differently, but they are fundamentally the same drives. Mine came as HGST branded, and I ordered mine from Amazon UK, but they were shipped from the US, and the seller in my case was Amazon Export Sales LLC. If they're a dud, they can be returned via a normal UK return process, so other than the delay in them getting here, this isn't an issue. But to be clear, that my results might not be the same as yours, given what I've just said, but I don't think that this is a reason not to look at these. You just need to take the appropriate steps to make sure you don't get stuck with bad drives. So my first observation here is the packing. These came better protected than even new discs that I've bought. They were also sealed in new anti-static bags and in physically great condition. Each one was bubble wrapped and individually boxed, and they also came in a bubble wrap packed outer box, so this was excellent. Visual inspection was good, and the drives were manufactured 6 years ago. Though it's common for drives to have a long delay between manufacture and installation, so really the manufacturing date is not the most important thing here. I have bought new drives before that are 3 years old, so we're going to be looking at the power on time and other stats shortly. So I have bought refurbished discs before that were dead on arrival. Notably, I bought some Iron Wolf Pro 18TB recently, and there were some DOAs. And this wasn't even recognised in a PC or an NAS, so these were properly dead drives. So the first thing to check that they are not dead on arrival. I have a Sabrent USB 3 enclosure that I use for this kind of testing, so it's quick to plug in, initialise, and to take a look at something like crystal disk info to find out about the disk. Some of the values can be difficult to extract, but the raw values in hex are the ones that you're interested in. For example, the power on hours down here in hex is 9850, but this equates to around 39,500 hours in decimal. The key thing to look for are going to be things like reallocated sectors, seek error rates, pending sectors, those type of things. And I actually typically prefer to pull the stats directly from Smart myself. And you can do this if you install Smart Tools on Windows or Linux. And you can get that from SmartMon Tools, the website, which I'll link below. This allows you to directly query the smart stats, and it has options to also export the data in JSON format, which is great if you want to build automation tools, you know, if you're so inclined. So let's look at more interesting stats on the drives that I received. Now, your mileage may vary, but I've seen others reporting similar kind of stats. So first of all, the manufacturing dates, and these range from April to October 2018 from the date of manufacture. So this equates to about 52 to 56,000 hours. And we can see that the power on time actually varies from 40 to 41,000 hours. So 10,000 hours is approximately 1.14 years. So all these drives have been powered on for about 4.5 years. We're going to come back to the drive age after we've looked at the drive's reliability and performance. Looking more into the smart stats, they've also been power cycled around 20 or so times, so that kind of tells you around what they've been doing during that duty cycle. The main concerning error rates are all zero, right? So they also report a 100% helium level. If you want to learn more about this, there's an interesting patent that's held by Western Digital, and I'll also link that below. So we can also see that the workload on these drives is a bit varied. Two of them seem to be very write heavy, and two of them were pretty evenly balanced for read-write. So the usage of these drives varies, and it's going to depend on the purpose of the host that they had them installed on. Okay, so the disks start. They sound fine with no audible whining, vibration or knocking sounds, and the smart stats don't reveal any issues. So next I'm going to run a full surface scan to look for bad sectors. So the disks say that they come pre-scanned, right? So if this is true, we shouldn't find any problems here. And for this, I'm using AOMI Partition Assistant, which I like, and I use it for a number of things. And this runs a full test of the disk, and this comes up clean, as you can see. There are other tools that do this. For example, you can use checkdisk /R, and this can also be used to perform a full scan of the disks, and you can see this here. Next, I ran a full performance test for all these drives, right? And this involves about 1,000 tests, where you copy 12 gigabytes of data to the drive using large sequential writes to fill up the disk and then read all the files back off the disk again. So during this test, the average write speed was about 194.5 megabytes per second across the entire disk, with a route at a peak of 250 megabytes per second at the outer edge, down to about 120 megabytes per second for the inner tracks. So the average time to run this test was 17 hours, 35 minutes and 10 seconds. So that's how long it takes to fill the disk. Interestingly, three of the disks performed identically, but one of the disks was actually around 4% faster than the others. And I don't see a reason why, as they're all the same model and they run the same firmware. Rerunning the test on the faster drive actually reproduced exactly the same results, so this wasn't just a testing anomaly. Now the read test produced similar results, and as usual, the results for read are a bit more uniform than that of writes. The read test completed on average in 16 hours, 44 minutes and 50 seconds, with again a peak of around 250 megabytes per second at the outer edge and 120 megabytes at the inner edge. The same disk from before again achieved around a 5% better performance, achieving 260 megabytes at the outer edge and 127 megabytes at the inner tracks. Again, this is a bit odd, but it's repeatable. So these numbers also match up well to the datasheet for this drive, which states that a typical maximum is about 255 megabytes per second. So these drives are running as per the datasheet. So the performance curve also looks good for both these tests, and there's no signs of any areas on the disk that ran into any issues. So having checked the smart stats, performed a surface scan, and performed extensive read-write testing across the entire disk, it looks like the disks are sound, so right now at least, and at 40,000 hours per drive. So the next question is, how much more life can I expect to get from this drive? And for this, I turn to data from Backblaze, who record and share publicly extensive data around a large number of disks they run in their cloud backup platform. So this data includes daily smart data, as well as install, decommission and failure rates for all their disks down to daily resolution. And I have all this data loaded into a SQL database, and it's been massaged so I can run queries against it and mine specific information out of that data set. So the disks I have are reported as HUH7212212ALE601s. And I'm going to link below to the drive in question. And this is an affiliate link from Amazon. So if you do buy, then the channel does get a small commission, but this costs you nothing. And Amazon links typically take you to the model. So although at this point it's highly likely to be a renewed drive, it is possible the links take you to a new version of this drive from time to time, and that the actual seller can vary. So just consider this when you check it out. So if we look at the data sheet, that rather painful part number breaks down to the following. So it's a Western Digital Ultrastar drive. It's helium filled. It's running at 7200 RPM spindle speed with a maximum capacity in this model range of 12 terabytes, with this specific model also being 12 terabytes. It's running a generation code. It's built in a 3.5-inch 26.1mm height physical form factor. This drive is configured with 512E sector size, and the 0 here is a reserve field, and the 1 at the end here apparently means that it's a self-encrypted SAS drive, which is a bit odd as this unit is certainly a SATA drive. Okay, if we look at the Backblaze data, they don't appear to use this exact model, but they do use three similar models, all with all the stats of the drives being very similar, save for two of those that either use instant arrays or secure arrays, and one of the disks being a native 4K sector drive rather than a 512. But it's probably reasonable to say that these should be mechanically very similar, and they're probably a reasonable comparison point. We can see that Backblaze has used 2,673 of the ALE600s, 13,500 of the ALE604s, and 11,500 of the ALN604s. So that's a total of 27,600 or so drives. So this is a pretty good data set to look at. So if I graph out the annual failure rate for each of these drive models, based on the drive age, we can see that all the models follow a similar pattern, and this is consistent with the bathtub curve you might expect to see on AFR data for hard disks. So to be clear, this data is based on the drive age and not the date. And this best represents how each model failure patterns look over time, regardless of when it was installed. And this is typically more useful than looking at data based on date, because when you slice the data based on date, you know, you can't necessarily tell if a drive that failed on January 1st was brand new or 5 years old. So this graph gives you a clearer perspective on what you can actually expect reliability-wise as the drive ages. And also to reiterate, AFR data is statistical data across a large data set. It doesn't mean that a specific drive will fail or not fail, just the percentage chance that any given drive may fail in a given year. So all of these drives start out by suffering about a 2-2.5% failure rate initially. And it's common to have higher earlier failures, and this is caused by things like damage in transit, handling errors, manufacturing defects, these type of things. The AFR then settles to around 0.5%, give or take. And then for different models, we see a start of an increase in failure rates later on. For the AL600 drives, they look to be holding steady on a course at about 0.5% failure rates after 5.5 years. The ALN 604 4KN model sees a rise in failure rates from about 3.5 up to 5.5 years, where it hits 1.5%, but then it seems to stabilise. And the ALE 604 model is stable at just under 1% after 4 years. So this is all the data that's currently available, and it's current up to the latest available BAPLIES data that was released in June, and that was all that was available at the time of this video. So we don't currently have data for these drives beyond around 6 years. However, I think it gives us a good indicator when we see no current trend, at least, in increasing failure rates past these ages. Now, we can combine this data as well, and we can look at the kind of holistic data of all of these DC520 model discs. And this shows that the AFR for all these discs combined is stable at around 1.2%. And this is a pretty solid AFR for drives of this age. And it shows that HGST drives do appear to last well. Other data from older HGST drives also shows good rates past 7 years. So I have a video that covers AFR on a number of 10 terabyte plus hard disks, including ones from HGST, Western Digital, Seagate and Toshiba, and I'll also link that down below. So given my drives are 4.5 years old, they sit right here in the failure rate curve. So today I might expect them to have just under 1% chance of failure annually. Though these drives could, of course, fail at any time, they could all fail today, or they could run for another 8 years. It's a good indicator, however, that since I appear to have healthy drives, I should probably expect a reasonable life out of them. So at this point, it's worth pointing out that you can also buy Seagate Exos 12TB drives as renewed drives, and they're typically very similarly priced on Amazon. It's hard to say the exact age on any given refurbished drive, but I suspect that 4 to 4.5 years is likely the place that they get decommissioned from data centers. They could be replaced by higher density units, but as they have a 5-year warranty, I think it could just be that it's a good point to refresh them before the AFR starts to rise and before the warranty expires at 5 years. So again, BAPLIES data doesn't contain stats on the exact units on sale on Amazon. However, there are a number of 12TB Seagate Exos units in the data, and they vary from the X12 to the X16 model, because Seagate structure their drive models slightly differently to Western Digital and HGST. So if we look at the data from these 12TB Exos units, we can see that the newer the range, the better they seem to perform from a reliability perspective, which is good. However, the failure rates are higher than the HGST drives, and though the X12 drive seems to have stabilized at 2.2%, there may be signs that others could also, and the rates on the X14 and X16 still do seem to be rising, indicating that Seagate drives don't seem to age quite as well. Also, the NM0127 model I see on Amazon currently is likely an X12 model, though it doesn't seem to be listed on the X12 data sheets. And the X12 does have historically a lower reliability than the newer models. So I don't dislike Seagate, by the way, and I run quite a few of their Ironwolf Pros and Exos drives. And their failure rates are not hugely higher than HGST, but I would probably pick HGST up over the Exos at the same price point for all the reasons I've kind of mentioned above. Okay, let's get to conclusions, but first, please share, subscribe, like, etc. You know the drill. It's a huge help for fueling the algorithm and helping me grow my small channel, and honestly, it's really genuinely appreciated. Share your experiences below. Also, if you've bought these types of drives, what your experiences are with them, and especially if you've had the unfortunate opportunity to test the warranty coverage, which I'm going to mention in a second. Okay, so firstly, the disclaimer that, again, your mileage may vary, and it's possible that as the supplier varies for these drives, that the experience may also vary. However, they are covered, first of all, by a 90-day replacement or refund policy from Amazon, and Amazon claim they're also tested, cleaned, and refurbished as necessary. Now, I think the as necessary is a bit of a get out here, and clearly my drives are not really refurbished or renewed, as I would describe it. I would certainly describe them as in good condition, and they came sealed and well packed, but I would say, in short, that they are secondhand. But they do appear to be in good order with a reasonable life on them, and given what we see in the AFR data, there's no reason to think that they are not tested. Mine passed all the tests just fine. Also, when you add these to the basket, you do get an option provided for a warranty, and it might be a natural thing, I know for me at least, to just click say no and click past this, right? But this warranty appears to cover the devices for 4 years for a total cost of around $6.50, right? And if the device fails, you don't get a replacement, but you do get a gift card to cover a replacement. So, and from my reading of the terms, this would be for the purchase price of the drive. I think this option significantly de-risked this at really quite a reasonable price, so I chose this option for my 4 discs. Of course, I have not tested this warranty, and hopefully I won't need to, but I am also naturally skeptical, right? But I did read the T's and C's, and I don't see any alarm bells in those T's and C's. And of course, given the 90-day return policy, I think the main thing to do, even if it's a little painful, is to check the smart stats on receipt in the ways I mentioned above, and look for those key early failure indicators, and then run a full surface scan of the discs. Depending on the capacity, It may take a day per drive, but it gives you the opportunity to return the drive if it doesn't look good. Don't buy the drive, stick it in a drawer for when you need it, because honestly, I would say the same thing for new drives as well. So in summary, I think these are a great way to buy storage at a good price. The long-term life is going to be shorter, but you're also paying in the region of around a third of the price in many cases, and you're still likely to get many years of service out of those drives. Like, I've seen HSD drives in the past that have been running for 9-10 years. If you pick up the warranty, you can get the money back if you don't get that life out of them. So I hope this provides you with an insight into both what you might get on these renewed drives, but also how to test and validate these drives when you get them. So hit those likes, thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next.